More than 180 invasive species have entered the Great Lakes. Zebra mussels and round goby arrived in the lakes more than 30 years ago, and the lakes are still adapting to the change.
Three of the best-known invasive species in the Great Lakes arrived from the same place. Zebra mussels, quagga mussels, and round gobies all came here from halfway across the world, carried in ballast water by ocean-going freighters.
We kind of got a transplanted ecosystem from the Black and Caspian Seas. And actually, around 1988, the first zebra mussels were picked up in the St. Clair River.
Zebra mussels quickly multiplied and began causing problems by clogging intakes at water treatment plants and power plants. It was anybody's guess how the ecosystem would respond.
They come into a system, explode, and then you have all the different forces of predators, parasites, limiting food supplies, they all come to act on the population.
But even before native species could adapt to the presence of zebra mussels, a new aquatic invader showed up and changed things again, the quagga mussel. Harvey Bootsma is a professor at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee School of Freshwater Sciences.
Initially, the zebra mussels really took off, but they were confined to the edges of the lakes because they live on hard substrate. But a little bit later, the quagga mussel came in, and the quagga mussel can live in colder water and it can live on soft bottom. So it spread much more widely than the zebra mussels did, and it replaced the zebra mussels.
Bootsma and a team of researchers have discovered something surprising about mussels in Lake Michigan.
We wanted to see if there was any potential for controlling mussels, at least at a small scale in Lake Michigan. So in 2016, with support from the National Park Service and the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, we decided to start a mussel removal project.
The research was done on a rocky reef in Good Harbor Bay, between Leland, Michigan, and Sleeping Bear National Lakeshore. There, a team of volunteer divers spent weeks scraping mussels off of rocks.
The number of volunteer divers working with us spent several weeks that summer just going down, diving, and scraping the mussels off of rocks, trying to create a significantly large area that was mussel-free. And then after that, the objective was to monitor that to see what happened to that patch of rock.
Surprisingly, 4 years later, there are still almost no mussels in the area. The research team suspected round gobies might be responsible.
We think what's happening is the mussel larvae, or what are called veligers, settle on surfaces where they grow into hard-shelled mussels. If mussels try to recolonize these rocks, the gobies are eating them before they can grow to any significant size.
To test that hypothesis, the researchers put in devices called Hester-Dindy traps, which have spaces in them that are big enough for mussels but too small for gobies.
And sure enough, we're seeing mussels in those traps now. So it does seem like the gobies are instrumental in keeping the mussels from recolonizing the rocks that we cleared some time ago.
And taking the mussels away had other effects too.
Where we removed the mussels, we've also seen a huge drop in other invertebrates because they just don't have anywhere to hide anymore. So amphipods are a big one. Another one is isopods. Fish love to eat them if they can get at them. There's actually more of them now than there used to be because the mussel beds provide lots of food for them and they provide hiding places for them.
But once the mussel beds were gone, the fish could gobble up on the invertebrates while the gobies munched on mussel larvae.
Ironically, an invasive species, the round goby, it may be helping to control another invasive species, the quagga mussel, by feeding on them.
Round gobies come from the same place as zebra mussels and arrived in the Great Lakes around the same time. Gobies can displace native fish, partly because of their spawning habits.
One of their successes is that males guard the nests. As a result of that, they get a high fertility rate. And females can spawn, I think, every 2 weeks. And so they start in May and they spawn all the way through to September. Most fish, they spawn in the spring. If they get a bad spring, they lose the whole larval fish cohort for that particular time, but not round gobies. If they're spawning, you know, for 4 months, one of those times they're gonna hit the perfect storm of good conditions for their survival. and produce a lot of larval round gobies. And then the second big reason is quagga and zebra mussels, and that's a tremendously huge food supply for them.
For years, native species ignored the gobies, but things have changed. Today, natives across the basin are adjusting to their presence in surprising ways, and round goby have become a daily special on the Great Lakes menu.
Once they became abundant, fish, walleyes, northern pike, and smallmouth bass particularly, zeroed in on them. They're well known for eating crayfish. Their diet's really full of crayfish and other benthic fish like darters. So the gobies were a natural for them. It took a while, but they figured out how to catch them.
Native species like sculpin hide from bass by freezing and blending in. So that's what the bass are used to. But gobies have a different way to avoid being eaten, and it took the bass by surprise.
Because they have this strange behavior that when you scare them, they just kind of shoot out in one direction or another. That's one of the interesting things, that there was definitely a learning curve for these predators in how to catch these round gobies, and they learned how to do it.
And smallmouth bass aren't the only native predator to start feeding on gobies.
The other one that has recently been found to eat a lot of round gobies are the lake trout. We've been seeing some really big changes in their diets as they're shifting from fish like mottled sculpins and alewives to round gobies.
Another interesting story is the Lake Erie water snake, which previously was endangered, and they've made a real comeback because they love to eat gobies as well. So those are really interesting questions as we're going forward. What's the new Lake Michigan going to look like? And are there fish that are able to actually take advantage of this new situation?
The story of the mussel and goby invasion of the Great Lakes is still unfolding, but the impact has already been huge. The mussels have filtered the lakes, removing algae and absorbing industrial waste, making the waters clearer.
They're shifting back to more of the state they were before man interfered and changed everything. And so we're certainly getting close to that state.
What it all means for the lakes is still unknown.
Lake Michigan is like a moving target right now. We're trying to understand it, but the way the lake works is changing while we're trying to understand how the lake works.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for a newsletter at greatlakesnow.org.